This is the earphone audio response system, or EARS. Mini DSP was kind enough to send this in for a review, and today we'll talk about why they're not getting it back. So, right up front, let's define a couple of terms that we'll use throughout this video. RTA stands for real-time analysis, and it's basically a way to visualize the frequency spectrum. Just like that. DSP is short for digital signal processing, and as it applies here, it's a way to equalize the aforementioned spectrum by either boosting certain frequencies or attenuating them. This is how you correct the response of a problematic stereo, one riddled with unwanted peaks or dips. Here's how that works. Let's say that a speaker exhibits a nasty peak around 500 Hz, skewing the response by 6 decibels. Knowing this, we can intervene further back along the signal path, ideally before the amplifier, and introduce a 6 decibel dip around that same 500 Hz mark, essentially creating a preemptive inverse of the problem to come. So, now the dip cancels out the peak and the output from the speaker matches the source, despite its natural tendency to exaggerate 500 Hz. That's DSP in a nutshell, but before we can do any of that cool stuff, we need a way to accurately capture what's happening at the listening position. And when it comes to RTA gear for speakers that sit at a distance, there's really no shortage of options ranging from calibrated XLR microphones and their portable equivalents to complete RTA solutions like the classic SA3055 from Audio Control or the Termlab. But what about the speakers that sit on or in your ears? They're kind of a big deal. More than 300 million sets of headphones are sold each year. That's nearly the population of America. In fact, more than 40% of Americans use headphones as their primary speakers. Unfortunately, there's never really been an RTA solution for the headphone enthusiast that's both accurate and affordable. Until now. The unit arrived in a no-thrills box, which I can appreciate since most of what you're paying for is the actual device, rather than the packaging. And this becomes further evident once you go to pick it up. This thing is heavy. Accompanied only by a 5-foot USB cable, the weight of the package, as you receive it, is pretty much all within the stainless steel construction of the test rig. So let's have a closer look. Front and center, there's the interface box containing the microphone preamps, a USB jack and a bank of gain switches occupy the forward-facing panel. Further onward, there's the right microphone. Mini DSP uses 6mm condensers, very much like the type you'll find in most other RTA appliances, including the popular wand-style microphones. Coming around the back, there is a pair of mounting screws keeping the interface box attached to the stand, and the extra mounting holes allow for just under 2 inches of height adjustment. Finally, we come to the left microphone. The removable ear molds are made of soft silicone to mimic the air seal between the headphone's ear pad and the listener's skin. You might say they feel eerily realistic. No? Okay. And finally, the underside of the interface box features a standard quarter-inch threaded mount, which we'll come back to later in a review. There's also a serial number, which we'll talk about here in just a minute, but first, let's fire this thing up. And to do that, we just plug it in. It's a driverless interface, so the instant you connect it to a computer, be it Windows, Mac, or Linux, it is recognized as a standard 24-bit audio interface with a 48 kHz sampling rate. I won't cover the process of setting it up with any particular brand of RTA software, suffice it to say it works flawlessly with True RTA, Home Impulse, and the Room EQ Wizard. Prior to shipping, the microphones on each individual ears unit are tested against a perfectly linear source and identified with a serial number at the bottom of the interface box. If you scroll to the bottom of the ears product page on the Mini DSP website, there is a place for you to enter this number and download the left and the right calibration file compensated for over-the-ear headphones, in-ear monitors, or even just the raw calibration for accurate binaural recording. Speaking of accuracy, for the longest time, the most informed way to shop for headphones would have been to reference buildograph tools like the kind offered by headphone.com and pick the closest thing to the response you're after. Here's a headphone.com in-house measured response for a set of Sennheiser HD600s, and here's my personal set as measured using the Mini DSP ears. The placement of the aberrations along the frequency scale matches up quite nicely, and the difference between the shapes of the individual contours is likely due to the extensive breaking period since I've had these cans for quite some time. More to the point, the signal being fed into my headphone amp is coming from a DSP, which means that I can apply correction and turn this into this, which sounds astonishingly good. Mastering engineers, please take note. There are those who might say that response correction is not the be-all end-all solution to perfect sound, but it's certainly a huge step in the right direction. And it's a step that the headphone community hasn't really had a chance to take. not on a consumer budget anyhow. So, is this a game changer? I would say yes, and let me qualify that. If you're a headphone enthusiast, having one of these is all the reason you need to finally add that DSP to your stack. And I'm not even talking about a massive 96 kHz beast of a processor, just put something like this between your DAC and your amplifier. Good to go. If you're a music producer, you don't even need a hardware DSP, just use your favorite EQ plugin, save the correction curve as a preset, and drag it onto the master bus anytime you're monitoring through those headphones. In either instance, having one of these on your desk combined with some form of DSP gives you a newfound sense of choice when it comes to shopping for your next set of cans. All of a sudden, a less than ideal frequency response is no longer a deal breaker. Practical instance, I've had my eye on these Beyer Dynamic DT770s because of how comfy they are and the amount of isolation they offer. But what's this nonsense happening around 9 kHz? Well, I can fix that now. That's not an issue. But what if the response changes when I decide to upgrade the pads? Again, I'm ready for that. Anyhow, this is probably where I would transition to my closing remark, except, remember that quarter-inch mount we were gonna come back to? As it turns out, this thing is also a binaural microphone. Quick refresher. Binaural recording, not to be confused with stereo, is the process of introducing time and volume differences between the two channels to simulate the way we localize sound. And since regular speakers produce crosstalk, binaural recording works only with headphones. In fact, if you're watching this video with headphones on, we'll do a little demo here in just a second, and afterwards you should do a search for virtual barbershop. It's pretty freaky if you're not already used to it. So, the binaural effect is accomplished by separating a pair of microphones with an acoustic head shadow and forcing the sound to travel around it just like it would around the listener's head. Here's what a typical binaural mic looks like. Couple of XLRs at the bottom, left capsule, right capsule, not that much to it. Mini DSP looks to have taken a more minimalistic approach, and hopefully there's enough surface area here to simulate a proper head shadow. So, going mobile with the ears is as easy as plugging them into a phone. Again, no drivers, no setup. The only thing you might need is a USB adapter. When I'm on the go, my app of choice for high-definition lossless capture is the Field Recorder by Fitzinger Voice Design. It does well with external microphones, including this one, so let's have a listen.
This should be pretty good. Got a bit of a soundscape, got some traffic here. First snow of the year. I'm walking around it. How's it sound over there?
Sounds pretty good on this side.
Upon review, and as you've just heard to the best of YouTube's ability, the audio footage from the ears presents a reasonably vivid soundstage. I'm also impressed with how neutral the tone is, then again this is an RTA microphone first and foremost. The only downside here is the absolute lack of wind noise rejection, which of course can be resolved with a third-party windscreen. That aside, the ears from Mini DSP is a must-have for anyone involved in field recording or sound design, mastering engineers looking for that neutral sound from the monitoring headphones, and of course any audiophile looking to venture beyond the factory frequency response of their headphone collection. I hope you enjoyed this review, be sure to rate it accordingly, subscribe if you haven't already, and I'll see you in the next one. This is staying here. I already threw out the box anyhow. Cheers!